what's real, what's deception, what should we be paying any attention to, what is it that's driving us insane?
He knew the world would not be the same.
Something happening here.
Truth Connections.
Good evening. Welcome to Truth Connections. This is Kathy, and I'd like to thank everyone for being here listening live in the chat room tonight or afterwards at our archives of Blog Talk Radio or our YouTube channel, Truth Connections. Before we get started, I would like to give a shout-out to our longtime co-host, Rand Porter, who has many other projects going on in his life at this time and needs to take a break from the show. And on behalf of Tamara and myself, I would like to say we love you, Rand, and we thank you very much for being a voice at this venue for as long as you were. Many blessings to you, my friend. Our opening song was by a gentleman by the name of Fred Cusinato, and it was called A New Earth. And joining me as a guest co-host this evening is the one and only Fred Cusinato. How are you, Fred?
I'm doing pretty good. How are you, Kathy?
Doing good, Fred. Doing good. Thank you for being here tonight with us.
Well, thank you for having me, and also thank you for starting off the show with that song.
Not a problem. And for anyone out there who's listening who does not know, Fred is my resident 432 Hertz specialist, and he actually was on a show with us talking all about Hertz frequency, and if you haven't checked that out, it's a really good listen.
Yeah, thank you. That song was called A New Earth, which I believe we're entering right now, and it was originally done in 440 Hertz, which is the standard right now, and I retuned it to 432 with the software, which, you know, speaking of frequencies, I think it has it's quite a lot to do with what we're about to talk tonight.
Absolutely, and that's why I chose you to come on the show with us, because you, Josh, and Zach will be a great complimentary addition to the show. As you know, Fred, we had an election here in the United States today.
That's right, yeah. It's still happening as we speak, where they're counting, I believe.
Yeah, emotions were running high all around Facebook, I could see. And I think many are upset with me that I didn't vote today. I just couldn't participate in the matrix anymore, and it looks like I'm not alone, because this 57th presidential election, or should I say corporate puppet show, I read an article on PressTV.ir that 90 million Americans who are eligible to vote in the United States chose not to. So 90 million shunned the U.S. election out of 207 million eligible voters.
Wow.
Yeah.
I say that is pretty telling.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty happy to hear that, too, because I can say this because I'm in the province of Quebec in Canada, and we just had a vote for, I think it was the provincial elections, and I didn't bother. I myself can't bother either. I know that if I were to go to vote, it's like voting to keep on participating in the charade. So I'd rather not, and I'm really happy to hear this. I mean, it's
it was very difficult for me because, you know, ever since I was a little girl, not little, but much littler than I am now, 18, my father took me to vote first, and it was a really big deal, and I took it very seriously, and I voted in every election since I was 18. So it was not a very easy decision to come by, and only 150 million people have registered to vote and take part in the election. Now, just to take it a step further, Fred, I'm a registered voter, so I was actually registered to vote, and so was a few other people that I know were actually registered to vote. So this number must be a lot higher, because I did not vote in the election, and I know many registered voters who didn't vote, you know, and that's, who knows what the real number is, honestly.
That is,
time will tell.
Time will tell, I guess, yeah. I mean, we'll have to wait and see if there's going to be maybe another recount.
We'll see. I'm sure it's not going to go off without a hitch. Okay, on to our guest. Enough of that depressing business.
Definitely.
Tonight we have two guests with us, and we'll try to keep the conversation as focused as we can with all these people speaking. Our first guest I'm going to introduce is Josh Toms. He is a stonemason, an independent researcher, an artist who designs with geometric designs, and he has studied the work of Edward Leeds of Coral Castle and Nikola Tesla. Doing that, he gained a deeper understanding of geometry and the ratio of the Great Pyramids and Fibonacci sequences. Please help me welcome Josh Toms to the show. Hello, Josh.
Hello, everybody.
How are you?
I'm good. I went out and voted today.
Did you?
I did.
And I respect your choice to do that, Josh.
I voted third party. I could not do it, either side. But we had an important voting amendment here in Colorado to end Prohibition 2.0.
I understand that. And if I was where you are, I probably would have voted too. If I was in California, I probably would have voted to make mandatory labeling on GMO foods. You know, if I lived in a state where it was going to be that important to vote, I think I would have just wrote somebody in for president, honestly. But also with us this evening is Zack Covell, also an independent researcher who has an innate ability to translate between the sciences, pi progressions, geometry, and languages, sounds, art, spiritual myths, and teachings of the ancient times. Please also help me welcome Zack Covell to the show.
Hey, guys. It's 512 where I'm at, and that's the C note in 432 hertz tuning.
There you go.
That's interesting.
Not a mistake.
Timing. Well, thank you very much, Kathy, for the invite to the show, and I'm really excited to speak with Josh and Fred, and I look forward to seeing what emerges tonight. There's a lot of interesting topics we could discuss with regard to Coral Castle and the geometric connection to reality. So,
yeah, go for it.
It's going to be quite the discussion. I think that the audience might not be suspecting as many topics as we're going to actually talk about tonight. So go ahead, Zack, take it away with your intro.
All right, well, my first experience seeing and feeling my own energy that changed my whole perception of everything. I witnessed my energy in a meditation for 45 minutes, and I kind of was really confused. I began to seek answers as a result. At the time, I knew nothing about Coral Castle or Leedskalnin. I didn't understand anything about pyramids or geometry or any of that. I was just totally drawn, though, and really interested. I already had sort of a scientific background to find out what the heck happened to me. So after much seeking and learning and sharing between people, I sort of accidentally found myself turning into an artist. And this is because I couldn't visualize the meaning of things without seeing them at first or, you know, showing what I experienced inside. I asked the question so many times, how were our ancient ancestors able to carve out of stone with primitive tools these amazing structures? I answer that question just by kind of realizing that something happened. We fell asleep, we forgot, or we couldn't see the energy anymore or something. I jotted down a story. I took the time to sort of piece together something I think is very important that'll help demystify some of what seems so complex with these topics. And then it'll kind of meld and fall into place with how it does connect Coral Castle. Gathered about throughout the world is a secret doctrine or a mystery. And the knowledge and the teachings of old tell this story. And the story goes that the constellation of Virgo, which is the Virgin, is the water mother of natural man. And then the constellation, which is directly across the sky, directly across like a reflection to Virgo, is Pisces, the fish mother of spiritual man, to natural man and spiritual man, Virgo and Pisces. All first life originated in the seawater. You know, like we've heard that with Darwinism, the theory of evolution and people that brought about that teaching, mostly that science. Fish or Pisces is a birth in and from water. So it kind of stands patiently as a generic type of organic life that comes from inorganic life, that is water. The fish or Pisces kind of typifies life, the spiritual man embodied in the physical organic structure. In other words, organic life is sort of born out of water, and that's the first birth, the water mother, the virgin. But if life is to become a mother of something and give rise to itself, its child is going to be mind or spiritual consciousness. The ancients called that the son of the fish mother. So water is the mother of natural physical being, an organic structure that becomes later born again into divine mind. So it's kind of a strange thing, but water is a type of another thing, which is still more germinal and important to life, and that's namely matter. So matter is the physical world, the virgin mother of all life, and that's in the Aboriginal stories of Genesis. The native peoples of Earth tell this. All the things are generated in the womb of primordial matter, the old genetric story of Egyptian mythology. So by consideration of the nature of matter, the physical world, and its evolution, we're kind of enabled at last to kind of get closer to the true meaning of what this weird story means from the ancients, a double motherhood life. Oddly enough, matter, physical stuff we call reality, is seen to exist in two states. It becomes the mother of life at two different levels. According to the mysteries, primordial matter, or empty space, sometimes Egyptians looked at the sky back in the day, they called it Nuit, or the cosmic ocean, kind of like waters, like the cosmic ocean in the sky. Empty space itself, it's the first mother of all living forms, which is, in their sense, why they were so important on drawing and doing their art. The living form is geometry. It's spoken of in the Bible, too, and not just the Christian Bible, but a lot of old writings in Genesis. The Latin word I learned once was matter, spelled M-A-T-E-R. Now, how close is M-A-T-E-R to water, the parent of spiritual mind? Well, ancient books kind of group these two mothers in pairs, and they, of course, called that the two mothers, makes sense. Or they sometimes called it the two divine sisters. Another time, they were called the wife and sister of the gods, Isis, Ishtar, Sibyl. It's all old Egypt. They first called it Apt, A-B-T, and Neith, and later they called it something more New Agey, Isis and Nephthys. So what does this ancient sort of double mother birth thing have to do with that story and Ed Leedskalnin and Coral Castle? That's where we kind of begin, is all across the world, we see a pyramidal matrix, thousands of pyramids. Some are under the sea, some are on the land, some are in the mountains. And they're all placed at strategic points on Mother Earth, like vortex points. Our energy fields, our auras, are like those vortex points, our light body. So this is the kind of big part for me, was that I realized consciousness, like who we really are, where our intelligence really exists, is not in the brain. It sort of surrounds our whole body. The things we attract and then repel away from us in life are related to our heart's frequency. The heart wants to kind of express itself as a true divine mind, or some sort of reason you gotta die, supposedly, to your individual desires, to culminate a new birth through the waters and essentially magnetize your heart into adopting a new frequency, a higher form of geometry or shape or perception, multidimensional life. I fought with myself so much. I really wanted to achieve something, but I felt like every time I went deeper down the rabbit hole, trying to learn more, I just realized it never ended, and I was blocked. I was blocking myself with my own emotions, my own polarity, and vortex meditation helped me sort of get through that. I was carrying too much polarity in my body. I was out of balance.
But when I found similar to the way a lot of people awaken the rest of the way.
Absolutely. And essentially, that aspect of polarity is what, like Josh and I and others that study Coral Castle, use the word magnetricity. It's sort of just a combination of positive and negative charges and what the truth about that really is. So I kind of found my flow and birthing. My independent research connected me to super helpful, beautiful, loving people. I learned so much, and I sort of listened to more beautiful music than I ever listened to in my life. It changed me big time. My purpose here tonight is a bigger goal of mine, to unite purpose-driven entrepreneurs and scientists like Josh, but also artists, to together co-create a new vision for our planet. And just general awareness to humanity as a whole, and accelerate this, accelerate the intention to transmit and to teach and assist in a new opening of consciousness to other human beings. So I'll pass it off to Josh. I think he wants to kind of lead the way on that.
Take it away, Josh. Break it down.
Well, I was pretty, I couldn't focus in high school. I had ADHD, they said, and a lot of the time I just stopped focusing on what I was looking at. But after some hard times in my life, I started questioning reality a lot more. It's more of that surreal sensation that you obtain through, you know, the good and the bad. So it taught me to try and find that middle ground. And I mean, there's so many different avenues to express exactly how I got to the point I am today. There are so many great minds that I have communicated with it's overwhelming, the amount of information I have opened my ears to. And the Coral Castle story is the one that really just blew my mind. And the first video that I watched on it was from Jeremy Stride of code144.com. And it involves the geometric mosaic, or it's not really a mosaic because it's not tile, but there's a huge mural in the Grand Lodge in Philadelphia that is just beautiful. And they didn't just put this thing together because they wanted to. There is so much intellectual design and reasons for this building's structural architecture. It's mind-boggling, and it really just set me off looking down this technological hole of suppression. And it also comes from an intuition to look towards the ancestors because of some of the things that are just completely unexplainable. The jobs that I have had include circuit board manufacturing, and currently I'm running a machine cutting granite countertops. So I have the experience knowing how hard it is to cut these stones and how heavy they are. I also know that the chemical know-how of some of Ed's experiments in his book, Magnetic Current. He talks about using acids. He talks about coils. And I mean, this is the stuff that circuits are made of. Everything is in technological standards has circuits. So the geometry is just me observing the universe to try and really grasp what this is about. So I've got a quote here by Galileo back in 1623. The grand book of the universe was written in the language of mathematics, and its characters are triangles, circles, and other geometric figures, without which it is impossible to understand a single word of it. I mean, this is not a new idea. Pythagoras said, there's geometry in the humming of the strings, and there is music in the spacing of spheres. So where all this is coalescing is that Ed Leedskalnin talked about the Great Pyramid of Giza. And the Great Pyramid of Giza, he claimed, there was a secret knowledge of how it was built, and he knew this secret. And his castle is a testament to show that the knowledge is out there. He was able to lift a 32-ton stone. Now, the real question here is, there's a guy building this huge castle for one apparent reason, and that is to express his knowledge. The geometric aspects of what he conveys in his book, Magnetic Current, it's sometimes I get wrapped up in what avenue I should talk about because there's so many different connections involved with this research. And it literally is like the center of a spider web reaching out to all these different avenues. And one of the things Ed talked about was the electricians needed to get together with the physicists. And it's because we're so fixated in these different avenues, we're not seeing the whole grand scale of things. And it seems that geometry is expressing itself through nature. And you can use that terminology the other way around, that nature is expressing geometry.
Well, I think it's fascinating what you mentioned earlier about everything having a sound or a vibration, because people said it was rumored that they heard Ed Leeds singing at night at Coral Castle, but others thought it was the sound of the frequency, not him singing at all, from him moving stones.
And that's the more logical view I would have of such a thing. We can't just throw away the testimony of people that lived around him because of how strange the story is. This was a real living man, and a lot of the children that were involved, you know, living around and seeing his museum, and, you know, they'd give him 10 cents to go in. But these people lived with him. So to say that he was singing, you know, that's more of just adding a myth to it. And that's what I'm starting to see a lot more, is that there's myths. And, it's been 70 years now. It's kind of sad that we didn't hear about this in school, because I know as a kid, science was really the interesting thing for me. And one thing that kind of got me was it was so observational. I was always looking at what was going on, and it wasn't really what they were telling me was going on. It was what I was looking at. And that was where my curiosity is essentially gone, is I've looked through lots of different information, and there's a lot of researchers out there sacrificing themselves to try and express new information. And one of the researchers is John Depew. Now, John Depew talks about magnets having a north and a south pole and the neutral particles that connect everything. And he's created this equilibrious grid of magnets connecting each other, and they're spinning like rotors. So he said that magnetic current is sacred geometry. This is his discovery. So if we look at geometry as circuit connections of a magnetic lattice, then we need to be able to understand the information encoded in that lattice. It's like a computer program. If you don't know the computer program, you mess with a few numbers, your system's going to be completely out of whack. It's a harmonious grid. Everything is affected by everything else. Subtle vibration, and that's geometry.
Some people think that Ed Leeds had a magnetic energy grid map, and that's how he was able to move things from Miami to Homestead. There was even a time where they had to do some repairs on the Coral Castle, and they said that the repairs took a 6-man crew with a 20-ton crane to move, and one of the guys left in one of the trucks to bring some supplies to the other location, and he came back a half an hour later, and Ed Leeds had loaded this whole truck by himself. Ed Leeds, if anybody doesn't know, is a 5-foot-tall man. He worked at night. He was very reclusive, very secretive. So he definitely knew some things that were going on and how to harness energies in the universe.
Yeah, and some say that he did that with a simple pulley and a radio and some very simple tools.
A chain hoist,
right? I don't know if Zach wants to talk a little bit about that.
Sure. Ed had a 4th-grade education. I mean, if Ed can do it, he understands something so deeply rooted in the meaning of what the ancient teachings were trying to tell, which unfortunately in our modern day, those are myths to us. But it's tough to translate across from what maybe we should discuss that, Josh, is how the connected streams of individual magnets, North Pole and South Pole individual magnets communicate, how the streams talk, and maybe kind of nullify gravity in some cases. Maybe that'll explain some of the basics of what these magnetic forces were doing and what Ed figured out in all of his 4th-grade education and observation of the sky.
Well, Einstein was curious of the compass, so I take it, considering one of the first experiments in Ed's book of magnetic current is making a compass. Just that alone doesn't point true north. It points a little northeast. It's quite interesting, just the act of a compass. What is going on there? It's telling you that there's energy flowing in a direction. It doesn't tell you which direction. It just, you're balancing it, so it's a very subtle vibration. It has to be influenced.
And the influence is provided by the geometry that you set up in your experiment, or something a little different, like the actual metal you involve? Is it something like that?
Both.
I guess.
So okay. If you have the geometry of a tuning fork, you can make a vibration in that material by kinetic geometry. The geometry is in Ed's wheel is really the thing that boggles my mind. And he took apart an old Model T Ford and got the magnets out of it, and he put it on a flywheel, strapped it to a car crankshaft, and he cemented it in concrete. I mean, this wheel is beautiful if you really look at it. It's getting old, though, and I really think we need to take care of it.
They say that those doors, once they had to hire all these people to just fix this one door, that before they repaired it, it just took a child's finger to open the door. And even with all those people that repaired it and all the equipment they had, they still couldn't get the door set back the exact way that Ed Leeds had it set. He believed that magnets were in the Earth's crust, and he harnessed that energy. Is that true?
Here's a quote from Ed. This is about magnets. He said, "They are in constant motion. They are running one kind of magnet against the other kind, and if guided in the right channels, they possess perpetual power. The North and South Pole magnets, they are the cosmic force. They hold together this Earth and everything on it. Each North and South Pole magnet is equal in strength, but the strength of each individual magnet doesn't amount to anything." So he's saying that, you know, they're kind of weak by themselves, but obviously the sun is controlling and dictating the entire solar system. So it's about clumping, and that's kind of what I'm starting to see, because he said that magnets build up matter, and they can also tear matter apart. So perfect example, Edison's tungsten light bulb. The reason that light bulb lights up is because it's burning the filament that is made out of tungsten. And, you know, they say photons are shooting out. And, you know, if you really get down to it, there's heat being released from the filament. And when that filament breaks, your circuit's ended. Positive doesn't go towards negative, or negative doesn't go towards positive. So he's saying that all materials are clumped magnets. Well, that makes perfect sense. Magnets attract to each other of opposite polarities. So these things are clumping together, making different materials, and you can burn them by heating them up and they turn to something else. It's always a conservation of energy. But it's this, a term I've used is a magnetic viscosity. Viscosity is an example, a piece of cloth, and the magnets are honey or water. The honey would stick on the cloth and not pass through the material, and the water would pass right through it. There's an experiment about, it's called helium-2 superfluid, and they cool this fluid down to almost near zero Kelvin. And as it's getting colder and colder, it's bubbling, and at a certain point it becomes perfectly still. The entire sample has the same temperature. It is literally the same information all around. It's like a chord. It's in harmony. There's no differentials in the substance. So the reason this is important is they take a crystal quartz cup down into this fluid and lift it up, and the liquid will drip through the glass. So that means that the glass has little holes in it, that like a sponge that it can drain through. But certain sponges are, it's like mesh, you know, mesh can hold certain rocks. Zach, you and I talked about it once, the metaphor for how magnets are is you wanted to get the right fishing net to catch the right fish.
Right, right. Well, I remember to make it kind of less opaque and a little less difficult to understand for people, I think I mentioned that each particle in the substance is an individual magnet, and you're talking about matter being held together by the opposite poles, the opposite charges, the opposite, but there are two of each. So I guess the understanding of that, something dripping through the glass, means that all the forces were aligned in such a way that the right hand fashion or spin, something in the north and south currents, made everything within the substance, the glass, just kind of become not physical or not as.
The guy had some kind of vision that was given to him in a divine way. I'm totally convinced, because they say that Ed could see in chromosomes without a microscope. And what I find very interesting, Josh, is the kind of artwork that you do, the 3D artwork, that you seem to be able to visualize something coming to life before you even draw it. You can see it in a 3D matter when it's on just a piece of paper. And I find that very interesting about how visual you both are, you know?
Ed said he had the secret of the Great Pyramid of Giza. So what is the secret of the Great Pyramid of Giza? It is itself as a self-expression. The Great Pyramid is the secret. It is the geometry in the Great Pyramid. Jeremy Stride has done really wonderful work going into this, and the Masonic Lodge in Philadelphia has these little pyramids on the walls with these dots and these different geometries attached to them. So essentially what I ended up doing was took a pyramid, like on a piece of paper, and I drew a base and two lines. And the slope of this was 51.827, and that's the slope of the Great Pyramid. So you put this inside of a box, and you put some right – it's really hard to explain. A compass and a square and a protractor. It's like the Masons. They have the compass and the square. It's like riding a bike, or it's like playing the guitar. You have to pick it up and do it. And just to be told how it is not enough to really grasp what's going on with the Great Pyramid. But I have come to find terms that are great for expressing it. So as you're getting the geometry of the Great Pyramid, you find that you're creating these nodes called the square root of phi. Now, the square root of phi is exactly what it is. It's the Fibonacci sequence squared. So it's a square. There you go. It's the base of the pyramid. It's a square. So as you're building this geometry inside of a square, it gives you, just like notes in a scale, different fractal chords and fractal nodes. And the interesting thing about this is there's octaves even in this, where the fractal is reflecting itself. The overall, the geometry of this square is a circle. And if you really take it to the next level, you end up cubing a sphere. What I've really seen in this geometry is that it can be laid upon all geometry. It is depth, the depth of space. That means volume. It gives you what's in this area. And as you create the geometry of the Great Pyramid, you get your cornerstone, then your division line in the middle, and then the capstone. So the capstone, if you cascade in a flower of life pattern, the capstone sides outwards, it ends up connecting to the cornerstone. So in a sense, it is a fractal reflection. Obviously, the capstone of the pyramid looks It's like a broadcast. You've got a light, and you're shining it down a hallway, and it expands, right? It opens up. It is a fractal. That is what a fractal is something that is getting bigger, and it is holding the same geometry.
Yes, it keeps repeating. Some think that the pyramids are a geomechanical power plant. What's your take on that, Josh?
I would send people to Joseph P. Farrell's work. He is a very respectable man, in my opinion, on his research and how well he puts bibliographies and cites his sources. He believes that it was a power plant, and I can see exactly how that could be. Its geometry is like a tuning fork upon the universe. If the universe is a squared circle in a fractal algorithm of harmonically reflecting nodes, I mean, these are just different metaphors explaining the same thing. It's defining geometry. That's what the square root of phi is. It's defining geometry. It itself is an illusion, but the geometry is being brought out of this.
I've heard that before. Chris Dunn, I think, said that the Earth has certain geometries within it, and so if we can sympathetically resonate with that, we can harness that power and actually be in harmony with nature and not like have inefficient engines and crappy wasted energy like we have with a lot of the technologies today. And that, I think it relates to gravity, does it not, and magnetics?
It relates. It is all the physics. So it's like a unifying principle, this geometry is. It's.
Does that tie into nature's energy and the equilibrium grid, Josh?
Yeah, it's.
I know it's difficult to give visuals.
Maybe we could use the wheel or the Vitruvian man and the synthetic atom or magnetic tuning fork idea to help explain it. Because we want to reference the fractal nature of like the Russian dolls, one thing inside the other.
Yes.
And the Vitruvian man expresses that on Earth and the pyramid, right?
Yeah, we are a squared circle, according to Leonardo da Vinci's work. And if we are a squared circle, and the Great Pyramid is a squared circle, and the Great Pyramid has in its geometry a literal resonance of the geometry between the moon and the earth,
mm-hmm.
Something is going on here where these ancients were trying to express how they saw the world. It wasn't just because they built this huge pyramid. And speaking of, you know, the History Channel says that they cut the stone with copper. Well, I want to know how they cut the King's Chamber, which is all red granite.
I want to know how Ed Leeds got all that coral in one spot, let alone lifted it. But you can get back to that, Josh. It's just always baffled me. Where did he get it from? Do you know?
Well, he actually built it in Miami, if I'm correct, and then he moved it to
Homestead, Florida.
So he actually built that thing twice, when you think about it.
Yeah, and moved it twice. That's what blows my mind.
Well, what do you think, Josh? I've heard some wild theories out there. I've even heard that the whole tripod with the PMH, the perpetual motion holder on top, that the whole tripod moved. Or that's how the pulleys were able to levitate the stones. But also, I was looking into what type of coral it is. It's a oolite limestone. And I was thinking, well, next thing I'll check out is this superconductivity, or if that relates to this type of limestone and this coral, if the magnetic current would run through that kind of stone differently. Maybe that's how he moved it, is it's a specific kind of bedrock or charge different from other places outside of Florida. Do you know how he moved it for that 20-some-odd miles?
I know that the truck that he lifted the stone on had a solid axle and solid rubber wheels. Other than how he lifted it up, I have no idea how he would lift these stones. There's the guy in Flint, Michigan that can spin stones on their balance point, but he still hasn't done a 32-ton block yet. And,
right.
You know, I want to know how this guy quarried those things. How did he lift the first block, too?
Some think he harnessed the energy in the Earth's magnetic grid to do this, that he knew. He had a map. He knew where the Earth's magnetic grid would be the best to perform this procedure. And that's why he also picked out Homestead. And by the way, Hurricane Andrew didn't move those stones one bit when it came to Miami.
Well,
just saying.
Well, Ed's technology would put the insurance companies in a bind in Florida. So you've got John Hutchison's work. John Hutchison is a independent researcher out of British Columbia. I think that's where he's living nowadays. But he would use Tesla coils and Van de Graaff generators and a bunch of signals, and he'd just bombard things, and he'd get stuff to fly, he'd get stuff to fall apart, melt. And I'm not sure if John is on one of these grid points, so maybe that's why his experiments haven't been so amazing compared to Ed's. So Ed may have been right on the power grid, you know? It's like Newton's cradle. All the little marbles in the middle, as they go back and forth, just stay there. It's right on the end, that kinetic slam, that's where the real energy's at in such a fashion. So if you had the correct magnet wheel picking up the sympathetic vibrations that the compass picks up when it points northeast, it's all about geometry, and that's the whole point of this, is if you have a paddle in water and you're running it through the water, you have backspins in both directions. You have right-hand and left-hand twists. So Ed really talked about everything was in a right-hand spiral. So the main thing he wanted to tell us was how energy moved over a wire or how it went through the wire. But he talked it would flow on the outside of the wire in a right-hand twist. So he had a bunch of experiments, and people need to look through his book, Magnetic Current. You can get it at the Museum of Coral Castles website. You can get it on Amazon. So just a simple experiment. He just has a wire, and he taps it, and he has a compass near the wire. And it tells you how the energy is flowing over it. So if you put the compass above the wire, it'll point one direction. If you put it under the wire, it'll flip the compass around. So it's showing just the positive and negative flowing towards each other, and they're spinning in a whirl-like fashion. Positive flowing towards negative, like every magnet. You have a magnet, the opposites attract. You let go, they slam together.
What symbols do you think are the most important symbols in sacred geometry?
The most important symbol in sacred geometry, I would say it's a squared circle, or even the Rodin coils, Marko Rodin's vortex mathematics, that is expressing a toroid, which this geometry, it is expressing the toroid as well. There's so many different cultural symbols that really express that, and that's why I painted a picture called Cultural Reflections, and it has Ra, the sun god, flying out of the pyramid and all the different cultural symbols, like each one of them. Om, for example, the symbol, it's not really geometrically expressing. It's more of that note, the Om. It's each symbol has a different metaphor attached to this. Like in Taoism, the symbol is more about expressing our wanting to just be in the moment and really observe that observation. So it's kind of leading us to look at what nature is about, not defining it. One of the symbols is the Star of David or the Seal of Solomon. Some people say it's the most deviled symbol ever, you know, devil worship, you know, whatever. I'm trying to get past connotations of any stigma or, you know, pentagram drawing.
We do have quite a lot of those. We have the swastika as well, which is one of those symbols that's actually been misrepresented, if you wish, in the last century.
Yeah, exactly. That's a Tibetan symbol also. They found it in the Mayan lands. To me, it looks like when you flush the toilet, it looks like a little whirlpool.
Mm-hmm. It's essentially indicating spin.
Yeah. And,
but you were actually going to talk about the
The Star of David. I used to work at a circuit board place, right? And we would use film, and the film is like a plastic. So we cut it up, and I would twist it like a Mobius loop. And if you twisted this Mobius loop 12 times and connected it onto itself, it would literally manifest the geometry of the Seal of Solomon. The Mobius loop is a great expression of this geometry because it's talking about the inside and the outside of the world as being the same thing. We always think of things outside of ourselves or inside of ourselves. Well, you know, our heart is still filling up this space in the three-dimensional world.
We should probably take a break now so we can take some calls when we come back. Is that okay?
Sounds good to me.
We can go back into our information that we want to share. I would like to, at this time, tell everyone to please feel free to sign up for our YouTube channel. And please, by all means, sign up for our Facebook page, Truth Connections, on Facebook. We do not like to just mass add people. We like people to come there on their own free will. And please also check out our truthconnections.wordpress.com website to see archives of past shows, upcoming shows scheduled. Any books to guests that have been on our show, that you can find direct links to purchase their books there. And there's a great new documentary section that Tamara has added. And it's got a lot of information there, not just today for the guests, but even after. I would also like to send a shout out to the Occupy movement. A friend of mine on Facebook, Heidi Cole, is in New York, and this HARP chemtrail-induced superstorm that we had on my birthday, which is why we were not live last Tuesday, by the way. The storm made us shut down for a week.
I believe they called it a Frankenstorm, Frankenstein Frankenstorm. Kind of sounds made up, doesn't it?
Yeah, there's a lot of things that don't just look normal. Storms don't get to be that big around. It's just even Hurricane Andrew was not that big around. It just seems manufactured in some degree. Anyhow, there's a lot of people in the Occupy Wall Street movement who have been mobilizing to help by way of volunteering. So even if you're not in the New York area, you're in another state that was affected by the storm, I'm sure you can go to the Occupy Sandy Facebook page and network for people in your area, and the Occupy Sandy, capital NJ.org, or at the interoccupy.net/Occupy Sandy website. So if anybody is in those areas affected, or they need help, or they want to volunteer, please feel free to go there. Because, some people are still without power and they've had their houses ruined and they're unlivable. So if you can help, please do, because it's just not fair in this world that people have to live that way and not get immediate help of some sort. So we give Occupy and my friend Heidi a lot of props for making this known to us and our audience. And the break song we're going to hear is by Histrionic. It's called DMT. We'll see you back in about 4 minutes. I hope you enjoy it.
Life swirling in light, energy, and then I reached the end to everything. And now from this time, then I expected a small black dot, and then it just, as soon as I could see it, it like noticed me, and I shot. I was there on instant. The thing flew up in this little black dot at the end. So I saw it, so up and down, then all the dimensions are such a very
We are back. Thanks for hanging out with us tonight. We know you can be anywhere in the world, and we're happy you're here with us. The break song was called DMT, and it's by Histrionica. And we have a question that Fred is going to ask that was asked in the chat room, and then we have a couple calls holding.
Yeah, that was a question asked a little bit earlier by Joshua in the chat room. Here's what he wrote. He said, talking about expression of geometry in society, what do you see the current flow movement as? And he had in parentheses visual performance with staves, POI, etc., centering around circles, spirals, and toroids.
Well, for one, I know marketing uses it like crazy. It's aesthetically pleasing to your mind, so it makes us buy products. Architecture is big with geometry, obviously, because of structural integrity. If anybody's ever seen poi, you spin the fire wicks around on a chain. I mean, that's geometry being expressed. Phi spirals all over the place. Art is getting into geometry more. Alex Gray has been an inspiration of mine. His artwork is just beyond amazing.
Your artwork is also amazing, Josh.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.
I did my artwork more of trying to express these ideas that were building in my head about the fabric of space, and just as it was building and building. I mean, I have all the drawings that I did way back, and some of them, I'm like, what was I thinking? This is awful. And some of them...
You were thinking outside the box is what you were thinking.
And some of them, nowadays, I'm looking at like, wow, this is the same expression as what Ed was doing, or it's weird how you can pick up on these things and not really know that you're picking up on it. I mean, the truth is silent. It doesn't say that it's the truth. It is what it is. It's a self-expression. You know, the chair is red because it is a red chair. Now, my artwork is just trying to describe essential space, and that space is perimeter, area, flat, and 3D. So when you can take this geometry and you can lay it on other geometries, you're defining them with a fractal algorithm. An algorithm is information feeding, it's like a feedback loop. I can't think of a metaphor for a feedback loop. So it's the real complexity of this geometry is that it ends up giving you depth. So an example of this is looking down a tube. You know, the part of the opening of this tube near your eye is bigger than the end of the tube, you know, a mile down the road. That is a tiny little, obviously, you know, depth. So this geometry gives us those points where you can actually create an optical effect where at a certain point you can trick the mind into thinking it's coming back at you.
So do you think that Ed used that technology to make that telescope he made or that sundial?
He was more of tracking the North Star and the transition of the sun across the sky.
I wonder why.
The planets, although we consider them outside of us, very much are the same exact energy reflected within us. You look at a point outside of your body, and you're looking at a tree top, let's say. But in reality, because of the way the universe works, we see it outside with our eyes, but it's also inside of us in the same energy pattern or shape inside. So what does that mean? It could mean that by observing the stars for thousands of years, our ancestors mapped the shape that the planets make in the sky. And with Rock Gate and Ed's work at Coral Castle, you'll notice, if you look at some of the photos, a shape called the analemma, which is this whoop-de-woo shape that the sun makes throughout a year period in the sky. And through that, this is the biggie, Ed determined all the way back then that planets do not move around the sun, but instead move through space and follow behind the sun, making a corkscrew pattern, which is exactly the same pattern as our DNA. he shared that stuff. I think Nassim Harriman touches on this as well. Walter Russell in the early 1900s, a contemporary of Leedskalnin. What were you going to say, Josh?
Well, I was actually going to just jump in there and say that that would be Dr. Kavash Bhatt, B-H-A-T, I believe his name is. Nassim Harriman is a very similar one, but the one that I've seen with the real, like the corkscrew, like the planet following the sun in that corkscrew motion, I believe that's Dr. Kavash Bhatt.
Yes, you're right, actually. I mapped that with the Pleiades a while back in one of my pieces of art.
Sorry, Josh. I believe you were going to jump in there.
Jason Verbelli uses the term helical wake of the sun. I like that terminology.
I wish Jason wasn't away because he'd be such a nice addition to this phone call.
Oh, yeah.
I know he wishes he was here with us. Hey, guys, should we take a couple calls right now?
Go ahead.
Hi, how you doing?
Good, how are you? Do you have
doing
a question
really well.
For us? Good.
Yeah, my name is Jeff Bond. I know Zack Covell. I really appreciate always talking to him, and I'm just going to throw a few comments in because I really appreciate the your other guest's point of view. I kind of think along the same lines, but the magnetic is really important because basically it's basically basic iron, and it's just basically a component within larger planets. So a lot of it has to do with scale, but if you move a magnet past a wire, or if you move a wire past a magnet, what you do is you induce a current in the wire, so literally you can make electricity. And you know, so large enough of a magnet or move something fast enough, and you're going to make a lot of electricity. So you really also through the scale determine relative effects. So you know, therefore we're influenced by massive galactic magnets, planets, stars, galaxies, and you know, they're comprised, some of them, of the element iron. And so what's happening is somehow is not for us to decide. There's magnets that are key because they're moving out there in some fashion that influences and creates electrical currents inducing them. Is they do have a large, you know, part of our life, and I think that that's important. And you know, it's relative to anything that is that once you move that iron, it'll create electricity in anything that's conductive, whether it's aluminum or copper or iron. Is, you know, our blood is iron. So it could, you know, very possibly create electrical currents within us that get transferred down to Earth in some kind of a fashion we don't understand, but we know it's basic. But I think magnets are correct. And, you know, with regards to geometry, is I like that star cut because basically is the most basic of tools. You could take a stick and a rope, and you can use it to create the most precise of measurements through a star cut. So you can use that stick and rope to make a seven-pointed circle pattern that you can then make a perfect square from. And from that perfect square, you can then draw in a star cut, and then you can cut it into one-half, one-third, one-fourth, and one-fifth precise measurements. You can start to use a stick and a rope to make geometry that's incredibly precise. So I'm digging everything you guys are talking about. I just want to throw some ideas in and say thanks.
Thank you.
Hey, Jeff. Thank you.
I don't remember exactly the researcher's name, but he used a stick and a rope to figure out the perimeter of the Earth or the circumference. And
yeah, but back in the day, nobody had anything. They didn't have computers. We have to assume a very primitive thing is they were able to make things that our computers still don't really have the capacity to put together. And I'm a huge fan of yours, by the way, and you got really cool art, by the way. Thanks a lot.
Well, thank you.
Hey, is Zack there?
I am. Hey, Jeff.
Hey, Zack. Hi. It's like I you know, really appreciate everything you do. You've enlightened my mind a lot. So I love you, brother. And take another call. You guys have a great show, and thanks a lot.
Yeah, thank you for calling in.
Yes, thank you so much
That's a great point with iron. When I studied oceanography, I learned about how in the ocean, that's so important to the bottom of the food chain, and introducing new nutrients into the food chain is the bloomage of iron out in the ocean. But in the esoteric sort of mysteries, the inner teachings of some of the old ancients and that seven-pointed thing he mentioned, I think the iron is related to the planet Mars, actually. And it's a red planet, iron red. It's a heptagram shape, a seven-pointed star. Mars in astrology rules over Scorpio, or sometimes Ophicus, which is the serpent holder And in their ancient teachings, serpent means wisdom, kind of the balance of polarity, the positive and negative, or linking the two sides of the hemispheres of the brain. Other ways they look at it is Mars rules over Scorpio. And today, Mercury went retrograde, and we have some big alignments with an eclipse coming up on the 13th of this month, and that's related to Scorpio. So these energies that sort of fractal down into our reality are just essentially mimicked, mirrored patterns from the sky above to the earth below. And then we live these out. And I even wondered in my own mind before if we sort of are all trying to find an equal balance with all those energies within us individually. And then we can connect on a higher plane, sort of telepathically or otherwise.
Absolutely. Good point. As above, so below.
Right.
Keeps, always goes back to that, does it not?
Yeah.
Now, I noticed, speaking of irons and having the last caller talking to us about metals, I was wondering if Josh and Zach, if you guys could talk a little bit about monoatomic noble metals. They seem to have, like you were saying about iron and the heptagram shape, did you say that?
The seven-pointed star, yeah.
Yeah. If you could go into that a little bit more, because, there's more geometry in there. And,
The bringing up monoatomic elements really is a huge subject that brings a lot of questions and not very many answers right now. A lot of the research came from David Hudson and his he was trying to analyze the soil out in Arizona at his cotton farm, because some years he'd have these great crops and the next year it'd be dead. He had to cycle through his fields. So he's doing acid leaching. This brings up Ed, because Ed talked about watching stuff dissolve in acid, and that scientist really didn't know what was going on in acid, and a true scientist would one day find out what is going on. So David Hudson would tear apart the dirt. It's rock. It's black sand. It's red granite. I live in Colorado where Tesla came to do his experiments, because the static air, it's really dry, so everything's all static electricity filled. And the dirt, it's not like what's out east with Kathy out in Delaware. Like, it's not soil, it's dirt, it's rock, it's the mountains eroding. The Rocky Mountains are very old, it's just, so he was dissolving this material, and he was finding that there was this material that he couldn't destroy in any of the acids, and he would take it outside to let it dry, and it would blow up in a flash of light and be gone. You have to look at David Hudson's work on YouTube, search a lecture. It is astonishing what is going on in the research of nanomaterials. And, a nanomaterial is like talcum powder. It's really powdery material. And what they're finding is that the only way they were able to test this stuff was by using arc spectroscopy. If I even said that right. But here in the U.S., we'd only burn materials through an arc for 15 seconds, but the Soviets were doing it for 75 seconds. So David Hudson ends up working with Soviet and German scientists in his research, because the U.S. was behind. We didn't know this stuff. We were too fixated in our own work to look at other countries. The Russians actually published a book called the Analytical Research of the Noble Group Elements, and this book just goes into rhodium, iridium, platinum, gold, silver, pleiadium. All those noble metals that are, they call them rare earth, they're valuable.
Superconductivity metals.
So
that's right.
Well, they're conductive as a metallic form. When we have them in this nano, it's essentially a crystal, and it's creating a Meissner field around it, And a Meissner field is superconductive. And how David Hudson put it, he said it can sense the twinkling of stars. That's how conductive it is. So in alchemy, they talk about, you know, the where the position of the planets are is affecting the it's like quantum physics. You know, your mind is affecting the experiment. There's a conscious observer. Well, you know, a planet is observing it through its subtle vibrational spin. Not literally it's observing it with its eyes, you know, saying, "Hi, I'm Jupiter, I'm looking at you." No, it's spinning. It's creating an energy disruption. It's part of the experiment, and that's how conductivity works, is everything is influencing this material, this superconductive material. Well, if we're saying that the universe is a fractal organism or a fractal reflecting, cascading, geometrical prism or a hologram is the best way to describe it. It's a illusionary hologram, a mirage of separation. It's just magnets all over the place. This geometry is inside of this material. It's just so fine. And I mean, the David Hudson was talking about, it was octahedrons was a lot of the shapes he was seeing under crystals. So, and each element had a different crystal pattern to it too. And, you know, I took a chemistry class in college, and they had a periodic table with all these numbers and everything, and on the other side it had the periodic table with all the crystals. And the guy told me that side was useless. Keep the other side there for the class. Like, you're telling me the shape of the geometry of these crystals is useless? Okay, so if you use these nanomaterial, because you can have other kinds of materials in the nano form, but the monoatomic elements are just astonishing. And Joseph P. Farrell goes into it. You can search Jim Mars. He's a researcher, a journalist out of Texas. He goes into it in one of his lectures on YouTube. You can go to David Hudson, obviously. You can go to Sir Lawrence Gardiner. He's a historian. He traces it back to the Ark of the Covenant. You know, we're talking, this is a white powder. And, you know, I'm just going to bring up the Bible because it's a historical artifact. You know, religious stuff aside, Moses came down from Mount Sinai, saw the Israelites had made a golden calf as an idol worship with all their jewelry. Moses was mad and he burnt the golden calf into white powder and he fed it to the Israelites. Very
monatomic gold, right?
That's what they're saying. So I'm not saying for people to go out and ingest this stuff, but what's going on is this material is going to change everything as we know it. It is like literally Newton discovering the apple falling on his head, gravity. It loses weight. When David Hudson was trying to patent this stuff, he had to weigh it. Well, when you heat it up, it loses weight, and when you cool it off, it weighs more than the original substance. It was a variation. There was no grounds to analyze it. Everything we had been taught was not working, and it is so amazing, and David Hudson explains it the best. So David Hudson, H-U-D-S-O-N. Well, the reason this stuff is important is that it's in the transition elements, and they're saying that these transition elements are monoatomic, meaning a single particle. So that means these gold bond, it's just gold reacting with the air and it's building itself. A man named Dr. John Milowski, he's a ceramic PhD physicist out of Santa Fe. He was using a microwave and magnetite and crushed quartz glass, and he was able to grow gold. He was able to condense these monoatomic elements out of the glass, he was saying. So the Egyptians worshipped glass. Their scarabs were made of glass. This knowledge, it may not be as technological and sophisticated as we see it, but it's old knowledge.
Is that not the transition then from the type of civilization we see today, type zero, to a type 1. I mean, I've seen the elements on the periodic table broken down into their geometries in the past. Some are tetrahedron shaped, some are cube shaped, some are octahedron shaped. So they all endow or embody different qualities. And, I mean, we're kind of getting really close, I think, to finding a way to hasten, or even, I don't know another way to put it, bring about, but I err away from the word manipulation of certain forces, but it's more like an understanding of what we're made of. So, and to not underestimate the power of this, but at the same time, there's probably some national defense, you know, issues around these materials.
The only reason David Hudson was able to get a patent on his superconductive, he said it was superconducting-like, because it had to have a certain environment and certain situation to become superconducting. So the Defense Department realized that they had granted him a patent, and now they're back filing a bunch of paperwork with him. It is Homeland Security and National Defense related in patents. They get involved when a superconductor is there. So they get classified. If we are to find a free energy or zero-point energy or alternative energy, whatever we want to call it, superconductive energy, how can you do it if you're classifying the materials that are needed to do it? And I've gone to school for electrical engineering. I didn't get a degree, but the components that are used in electrical circuits, they're not free energy components. There's a, you know, it's electrical components. It's called electronics. We need to create a new field called magnetronics or superconducting tronics, because these new energy fields are going to affect what we have. This laptop doesn't like when you run a magnet over the top of it. You erase your hard drive. We're going to have some situations going on as this technology is being expressed. And Ed's wheel is the focal point of what's going on. John Depew, he is on to something. He is a brilliant man, and you have to look at his YouTube of the Equilibrious Grid. John has studied Coral Castle for around 20 years. I mean, they gave me an experiment that really shows the geometry of a magnet, and it's a plasma cup. This cup is a vacuum tube, you know, all the air is sucked out, and they put a gas inside, and it's a mug, and you set it on its little stand, and it turns it on like a plasma cup or a plasma ball, those things you put your hands on, and lightning comes up, and it's, you know, it's a novelty item. So if you put magnets near this thing, it causes right-hand spirals around the cup. Now, the cup is hollow, obviously, so when you put the magnets inside, they spin in the other direction. So this is a question I have for Nassim Haromain as a researcher. What do you have to say of an experiment like this? And I want to also ask another person that is, they wrote an article recently about Coral Castle and saying that there was no real magic. Well, there isn't magic. When you use words like that to stigma, to put a stigma upon it, you're not doing any justice to the man that wrote a book that you haven't done any experiments, and that's Searl Allen. Searl Allen, he wrote an article criticizing Coral Castle, saying the man in Flint Ridge, Michigan, could do it. Well, he hasn't done a 32-ton stone, and until he can, I'm not saying, you know, you can't do what Ed did until you've done it. That's the point of what's going on here is, you know, people just brush it off to the side. They criticize it. They attack the person. They say, well, he sang to rocks. He lifted them with by singing. I mean, how silly is this? We're turning
it trying to make the person that thinks outside the box sound crazy.
Well, I mean, in the East, the Vedas, who have a lot to do with the spiritual scripture called the Bhagavad Gita, they had a spiritual science, which people sort of have a stigma about that today, in our modern day. But I think, I'm of the belief, and it's a simple way to state it, that the spiritual ancient teaching, which generally back then was sort of amidst the people who were the seekers, the ones who wanted to find the truth. Yeah, I mean, that science, we call it a science, but it was more to them like a way of living. It turned into, in our modern day, quantum physics. It's so profound. Like, science has mimicked what worked and always has worked. And now we're just trying to sort of reformulate an understanding where we can apply this to the society, to each other for healing, as well as anti-gravity, which is why I think the government and a lot of organizations protect this information. It's sort of sacred, but it's not supposed to stay this way forever. There's a transition where we move from this type of civilization to another. And this is the most pivotal, in my opinion, the most pivotal knowledge, is I recognized the importance of Coral Castle through all the things I'd looked at. I just sort of, I backed away and went, oh my gosh, Coral Castle, nobody studies it, but it's no wonder nobody studies it. One, there's no one presenting it simply, and two, there's very little information that's available for society. Ed only wrote a few books.
Some say that in Ed's books that he wrote a lot of it in sort of like a code, and he left spaces on the margin in almost like a way for you to try to figure out the code that was in the books.
That's his book called A Book in Every Home, and it is like a code, and the ones that we're really focusing on here is the magnetic current because of the experiments in it. And the reason people shy away from it is because they haven't performed his experiments. They're shying away from it, you know? Nobody has performed these experiments. Scott Lang is a man that I have deep respect for. He's from Australia, and he has performed these experiments. You can search his Facebook, or you can search his YouTube. It's the experiments that are what matter. Now, after the experiment, you want to observe it correctly. You want to see as it was seen through Ed's eyes, if you want to do that. So everyone's so fascinated with their own ideas and their own concepts. To get outside of the ego is what we need to do, and look at the information as it truly is. We don't want grants. We don't want, you know, all this stuff. We want support as a community to create a new technological renaissance. And the only way we're going to have that is by acknowledging that there's been people that have done this stuff. It is not woo-woo. It is real. Tesla did this stuff in Colorado Springs. And he did it at the Wardenclyffe Tower. John Searl has been doing it for ages. You know, I've never... Why would a man live to 79 years old working this long to try and get something that wasn't real happening? He's got something there. Stan Myers. I mean, these people are sacrificing their lives. You think that this creates good relationships? All these people end up alone. Tesla died alone. Searl's alone. His family left him. Ed died alone. This kind of stuff doesn't create, you know, friends.
I hear you.
It isolates people, and I can see it in a way with John Depew. He has kind of shifted back, and he doesn't want to share because he sees the impact of what this knowledge is. Are we actually ready for this kind of stuff? There's a negative side to this whole free energy movement.
Yes, let's talk about the dangers of some of this technology.
Well, the research that has really startled me, and Jesse Ventura supports her, Richard C. Hoagland has supported her. It is Dr. Judy Wood. Dr. Judy Wood has examined the physical evidence. No conspiracies with box cutters, no conspiracy saying there were no planes, no conspiracy with nanothermite, and if there's actually nanothermite. I'm talking about the investigation of 9/11. Dr. Judy Wood has concludedly proven in her book, Where Did the Towers Go?, that a direct energy weapon was used. This direct energy weapon is using some sort of physics that we don't know about in our public curriculum. John Hutchison is the only man that really is able to do these experiments, and he has shared it publicly. So John Hutchison is a very brave individual for showing the experiment of, you can search it on YouTube, iron block, John Hutchison. He takes an iron block, shoots it with a Van de Graaff generator, and the thing falls apart and starts fuming.
Yeah.
Okay, if you can vaporize iron with, you know, energy from a Tesla coil, static electricity, so to speak, you can do anything with a steel-structured building. Steel is iron with carbon in it, okay? Whoop-de-doo, what a big difference. It doesn't rust, but if you force it to rust, it will. I am not trying to, you know, take Dr. Judy Wood's work at all. I want you to look at it and support her. She is very brave for doing it, and the Supreme Court has not heard her case, and it's because they choose not to. It's not because they don't have the time. It's not because they don't know about the case. It's not because...
Because they don't want to open that can of worms.
Yeah.
Exactly. Who wants to be the judge to prosecute and try, or not even prosecute, but allow a true investigation of how it was that this has even been weaponized?
Well, then you have to, you know, kind of give consideration to, you know, those the legalese thing, right? Which, you know, where's the judge ruling from? He's ruling from the bench, and I believe bench is Latin for bank. So, you know, that's when you get into the, all of that thing, and then get into the history, like the money masters, and, you know, how did that whole thing started a few hundred years ago with the Rothschild family and that dude keeping one of his kids and sending off the other ones to France and you know, Italy and London, obviously, and all that stuff. And I think we're at a point where we're coming to an understanding of these things that maybe we weren't understanding. Like, I figure this. I mean, if I was around, you know, like 40, 50, 60 years ago, I probably wouldn't have known who Nathan the Rothschild is. And, yeah, you know, here we are today. We're able to talk about this stuff, able to talk about the issues. And I definitely think that's a step in the right direction.
Wasn't Ed the one that said that the world is not ready for this type of technology?
I believe that was Nikola Tesla who actually told Walter Russell to, you know, hide his ideas away for the next 1,000 years because humanity wasn't ready for it.
Okay.
Right. Well, so these theories aren't well understood in the public realm yet, but they're fully understood based on the work of Tesla and Leedskalnin and a lot of these suppressed sciences, where we are the ones now, where we have to be brave. We have to band together. We have to break our habits of going home and doing the same old, getting tubed by television. And it's sort of a time stealer, a mind manipulator, just in that sense. Sure, you watch your favorite show, but could there be something where you collaborate? Like, I sought out Josh. I sought out my friend who lived in Colorado near him, and I called him up, and I said, hey, would you go and film Josh's experiments in high definition with your camera so we can get this stuff out to the world? Because Josh is busy. He works full-time, he's going to school, and I'm not. So I saw a way to help. And I'm not an expert, but Josh knows so much about this very important piece. And superconductivity is not well understood, but Josh has made it pretty clear to me that I can look more. There's a lot out there. These technologies aren't really technologies as much as we're the one making the shift and representing a new movement from where we're at today to hunting down and connecting those that do see what we're talking about, and then hopefully attracting those others that can help pave the way and also pay for it, fund it. I mean, a lot of the folks in the sustainable and renewable energy community are starting to promote laboratories that currently don't exist yet, but they have a vision, and they're taking that and promoting it before it exists.
Who would you guys recommend the audience to donate to if they could for this type of technology?
Good question.
I would say John Depew or John Searl, John Bedini. I mean, there's so many different things, but we need to stop complying with our technological servitude. We need to come together and accept that this stuff is real. We don't need to just think that it's fake and, you know, Tesla said he made a death ray and, whoo, that was fancy. You know, that was a good publicity stunt. No, I mean, if Dr. Judy Wood and John Hutchison are right, the Tesla death ray was created in the 40s. This is a weapon that can change everything. It could be put into space. And we would be in a complete tyranny if this happened. And it is really concerning to me to know that the military-industrial complex has had trillions of dollars for the past 70 years, and all technology has done is put us to be $16 trillion in debt with a completely fraudulent election going on. People are being lied to left and right. The Constitution is being just degraded, and we still have the nerve to say that Nikola Tesla was a liar when we use his technology all over the place.
Right.
It is sickening to even say that Ed didn't lift a 32-ton stone. He just, you know, he just magically showed up. You know, there's no magic there, though.
Aren't you? Do you want to discuss the million volt march, since that's an action people can become involved with to get involved?
I started a movement called the Million Volt March. I don't have a date for the march. I don't have a website. We need to get this moving together with support. We need enthusiasm, people that actually want to get stuff flowing, because, you know, if you have the technology to vaporize a building like Dr. Judy Wood is saying they did with direct energy weapon that DARPA has created, we're in trouble if we don't step up and peacefully march and find a way to express that, you know, we have to have free energy technology because they weaponized it. It's not that question anymore that, well, we can't release it because it might create dangers in the world. You know, we have to be aware of those dangers in the world, but they've already weaponized it. They, meaning, I don't know who it could be. It could be Lockheed Martin. It could be Northrop Grumman. I don't know exactly, but I know that NIST did science fraud when investigating 9/11, and that is brought up in Dr. Judy Wood's case. And what is actually going on here is that science is fraudulent right now. They are lying. They are teaching people based off of their grants, based off of their own theories, based off of their own book sellings. They are grandstanding. These people want to be Einstein 2.0. It's not about being somebody else. It's about being yourself, standing in the truth, and expressing what you believe in and what you actually see happening in this world. It's not about Jersey Shore and this fantasy reality. There's a real world going on out there, and there's power being pushed. And when buildings just fall apart, breaking the laws of physics, falling the speed of gravity, and I mean, it is so frustrating to me when people won't even look at Dr. Judy Wood's work. It is astonishing how detailed she goes into it. She's a PhD in molecular engineering, or she's got a master's in structural engineering. She's got the credentials to investigate this stuff. It's a forensics case. It's not a political movement and the political movement was the 9/11 Commission report. The reason I bring this up is because, for one, it was free energy technology being used, you know, direct energy weapons. The other reason I bring it up is because since 9/11, this country has fallen into a tyrannical landslide. It disturbs me because I'm 24 years old and everybody's saying, don't look at the past, don't worry about this stuff. And, you know, I'm not worried about it. I'm aware of what happened and I'm standing up for truth right now. And I'm saying that something happened that day. I knew it in my gut the day I saw it. And I have been persecuted ever since because of just asking questions.
Josh, why don't you tell everyone and Zach where they can connect with you on Facebook so they can get more information about what you're talking about?
My Facebook is just Josh Tom 7. The number 7 is, I guess I'm the 7th Josh Toms.
How about you, Zach?
I have an email and a website. I'm going to start blogging again full steam in January next year, so a couple months. I've got things in order to do so. I have about 2,000 pieces of art that all have education and pieces of my understanding as I put together the art that I'm going to blog about. You can find, you can connect with me via email at Zach, but I spell it different, Z-A-C-K, at Zack Covell, which is spelled Z-A-C-K-C-O-V as in Victor, E-L-L.com. So email is Zach@ZackCovell.com. And then my Facebook's really easy, Facebook.com, and then just Zack Covell. I have an additional fan page that's Covell, my last name, and then just the first letter, my first name, Z, Covell Z, or Covells, as they say. And that's my Facebook fan page where I'm not looking for fans. I just simply share additional things that I don't share on my personal profile there.
Right. Understood. What else can we talk about, guys?
Well, I got to say there was something that Josh had mentioned earlier. I can't, you know, pinpoint it right now, but it did make me think of a quote saying, "Nothing is impossible except that the state of your mind makes it so." And that was a quote by Professor John Searl. I was wondering, actually, if you guys could talk a little bit more about John Searl and his Searl effect generator.
The SEG?
Yeah.
Oh, Searl was one of the first things I saw. I saw this video of the wheel spinning, you know, his little rollers going around the outside. I'm like, what is this? So I start looking into it, and I ended up on Facebook, I ended up meeting Jason Verbelli, and he was really supporting them. So that same year, this was in 2010, we both went to the Tesla Tech conference to see John Searl, and we both were at a dinner table with some very, very amazing people, and John Searl was at that table. So that weekend really expressed me to what was going on in Searl's work. You know, he has different elements working with each other. I know that there are some questions about Searl's work that, you know, involving eddy currents, and if as the magnets move by the coils, if it causes a lag effect, and how, you know, there's a lot of issues going on that we need to just explain this and find out if this is really what happened. And, you know, I could tell John Searl and all the people of his team were very sincere in their heart, and they were just following this idea that Tesla started with. And Searl's wheel is just creating in a different style way that the Rodin coil creates. It's creating a toroid, a donut, a smoke ring. It's creating a feedback loop effect where the energy that's caught stays inside. It's very impressive that the elements that he put into it, because from looking at the electrical side of things, you know, Teflon, that's a great insulator. Neodymium, that's a magnet. It's great for... there's so many aspects of neodymium. That is a very important thing. Copper, you know, it's a conductor. It's diamagnetic. And then there's iron, which is magnetic. So just the different elements tell me that there's something interesting going on in his work.
Yeah, definitely. I don't know if you've noticed him using the term reverse gravity instead of or inverse gravity, I think it might have been.
Yeah, it's the inverse gravity vehicle. Russell Anderson is working on that. What they're saying that does is essentially is it polarizes a craft so that one polarity is focused on the top and one polarity is focused on the bottom. Well, that technology is in use right now on the stealth B-2 bomber. They have high atmosphere, I don't know the exact terminology for it, but it's ion propulsion, where they allow the air to move through the jet to ionize it, And as they do it, they polarize the tips of the stealth bomber so it can fly around the world without using gas. I mean, this stuff, we're using amazing technology, but we're doing it military style. We're not helping anybody by doing this stuff other than wars.
Do you want to talk about some of the military technologies, the space-time and time-space?
Well, Andrew D. Bishago is somebody who really fascinates me because of certain key terms that he's used in a lot of his interviews or lectures. I think it's best for people to go and look at his information for themselves. He talks about Nikola Tesla, and, you know, he's going to run for president in 2016, and, you know, running for president, everything comes out. So we're going to find out the truth if he runs for president. And, that's courageous to do. And to stand in your truth, he says he is. You know, there's some amazing technology out there. We've funneled trillions of dollars into the best scientists the military could find, and we stuck them underground. What do you think they figured out?
A lot of things.
Exactly. And it's not about speculating. It's just stating the fact that all this funding has gone into what? That is the key question. What is it our taxpayer dollars has actually done?
I know you've worked with someone else who's been on our show, Fernando Vossa.
Fernando, he had me out to an art show in San Diego, and I met Fernando at the John Searl table that night. I went to the Tesla conference, and Fernando is an amazing man. He is starting a thing called the Global Energy Movement, and then the Center for Mass Creation. That's the Center for Mass Creation is this laboratory of technologies to empower humanity, to help us, you know, water technologies, free energy technologies. Fernando's the one to go to on this stuff. See, what I see myself as is a conduit between all these different people that somehow have come into my life. And it is remarkable to see all the different technologies, to see all the different views, to see just, it's humbling to know that there are people like this out there that are sacrificing the normal life of kids, car, job, all of the above, you know, the MTV life. Fernando he's doing a good thing, and he's wanting to empower people, and that's what we need to do. We need to look up, and that's something Searl said. That's something, you know, we intuitively do as animals, as we lift our chin up, you know, that's an old English term, chin up, mate. And we need to be empowered. We need to stop thinking that this tyrannical government has destroyed everything. You know, we need to be aware of that stuff, but we need to empower ourselves and say that they don't have full control over us. We still got our Second Amendment, you know. Nobody's going to be busting my door down anytime soon. They got my Make My Day law here in Colorado. So I'm just saying that we have time to fix what we have been – we've been negligent. We've allowed all this corruption to happen because we are enjoying the privileges of liberty. My grandfather fought in World War II. He was a second-wave stormer of Omaha Beach. The bloodiest battle, you know? I mean, this is the battle that Steven Spielberg put in Saving Private Ryan at the beginning. You know, my grandfather told me during the Bush years that he died in 2006, and, you know, God rest his soul, he was an amazing man. But he told me that what was going on, these foreign wars, interventionism, we were acting like the Nazis. We were starting to fight wars preemptively to start stuff. Unconstitutional wars. You know, I'm doing this because my grandfather really sacrificed a lot. He went through far more than what I have. And if we don't stand up for something that we believe in and to really stand in our truth and stand up for your rights, like Bob Marley says it, to stand up in our truth and stop acquiescing to our own tyranny.
Take the power back.
Yes. We got to get mad as hell and say we can't take this anymore and go find what we're fighting for.
Right there with you, Josh.
Well, we can keep elevating. We can keep pushing. But also, like the alchemists, we are the observer of our own doing, our own experiment, and our own outcome, all in the same mirror. So, I mean, I see a lot of us that can bridge this gap just fine, but we can't have the idea that we can accomplish the goal tomorrow or next month. So I'm going to be steady about it and understand that anything good, sometimes it takes a little while. And to raise this awareness is going to take some time too, just like it's taken time through the ages where this stuff's been suppressed over the last 100 years. And now we're starting to understand it. We've got the internet. We've got ways to connect that are far more superior to what was available before. So we can move at a faster rate just from that connection alone.
Absolutely.
Bill, if I can bring it back a little bit to the magnetism and the micro and the macro, I mean, we're here able to essentially to manifest the life that we want. And I think what we have to work through is a lot of interferences, be it on a conscious level or on an unconscious level as well, where, they might, drop a little hint of actual, good news. If you're the kind of person that watches the 6 o'clock news every night, you might get a hint of positivity, but it's murked in all this negativity. Somebody got shot, somebody robbed someone else, and there was a fire over there. I think it's up to us to make sure that we create the future that we want to create. And, if I can bring it back to the whole magnetism thing here, I believe, as far as I'm concerned, in the last couple of years, I've gotten to connect with a lot of amazing people. And Zach obviously is one of them that I met about a year and a half ago when I was going through some changes and learning a lot of intense stuff. And it just happened that way. And I believe that it has to do with the magnetism of the universe. We're attracting one another.
And vibration is everything.
Right on, brother. That's right. We're investigating what is. We're here. And there's so many venues to share now and heal and wake up. But most people are afraid. Bottom line, they are stuck in a rut with the suggestive norm, the thing that society says is right, so they don't get ridiculed, they don't lose their footing where they are in their life.
It's the Care Bear mentality. They're comfortable with how things are.
Right.
Care Bear mentality, I like that.
So let me bring up an important experiment a man named Michael Schneider did. He took pieces of glass and pressed a ferrofluid, which is like ink toner. It's a magnetic fluid. And he pushed it between this glass, and he had little LEDs of different colors around it, and he'd bring a magnet up to it. The geometry that showed through that lens was a dream catcher. You can search it. It's called Magnetic Warp, Michael Schneider on YouTube. Kathy, you were saying what a symbol that really is a great expression, the dream catcher. The dream catcher, it's beautiful. It's a better take on magnetics than all of our physicists have come up with. The Native Americans were so humble to give us that.
I feel that the straight lines in the Platonic solids and the curved lines in other forms and geometries that are shared, there is a complement that exists between the two of those, where spirals or phi or a complementary design where it's not a phallic male straight line thing, and it's not just the basic sphere of curves, but there's another venue, another realm where the harmony really jumps up multiple notches. Call it the seventh Platonic solid, for lack of a better term. But there is a unification to all the theories, and I think the universe is helping bring that about. Also, we can't stop, or we won't recognize what it is when it arrives.
As Terence McKenna put it, it's the transcendental object at the end of time. It's the object that tells us that there is no time. So the object that tells us that there is no time is the geometry of the Great Pyramid. It's a two-dimensional template that can be broadcasted upon three-dimensional space via a hologram, just like a movie screen projecting. it's all a reflection of this same geometrical principle of prime numbered quadruplets. Jeremy Stride goes into that, and I support him very much. You know, all these people have a part in this. We just have to really acknowledge that geometry is the true science. Experiments are also a true science. And, you know, here's a Nikola Tesla quote. Today's scientists have substituted mathematics for experiments, and they wander through equation after equation and eventually building a structure that has no relation to reality. Well, here, I'll give you a structure that is relative to reality in relation. It is depth. It is the square root of phi and how a room gets farther away from you as you look away. You know, it's a tunnel. That's what this world is. It's the geometry around us. And here's another example. The scientists of today think clearly, or think deeply instead of clearly. One must be sane to think clearly, but one can think deeply and be quite insane. like I said, back in elementary school, they got me with ADHD, so...
it's all good, bro.
You're not the only one.
but this geometry is literally defining perimeter, area, space. It's given us true volume. It's area. It's hard to express. Jason Verbelli and I came up with a geometry. He suggested to me that I tried to imprint this geometry on a half sphere, because in the Platonic solids, you know, you can define all the different Platonic solids. The one that we just put there as, oh, it's pi, it's 3.14, 22 divided by 7, you know, whatever you want to say pi is, we just say that's it. Well, the sphere is actually a layer of rings, or a great metaphor is there's a NASA experiment where they took us water in space, and, you know, it's a perfect sphere. It's awesome. And when they would puff a little air through the water, it caused these waves to go in and out of the sphere. That's what the sphere is. It's essentially each layer, like an onion, it's little rings on the surface that are being defined. And it is really hard to express exactly how the sphere's geometry is. I would have to do a presentation or a class of some sort to express this, other than with my artwork, which is a great link to look through, is my artwork on Facebook, because I'm using the same geometry on everything. Every piece of artwork is just the same geometry expressed in a different way. I'm using the same laws on everything. It is simple, but so complex. And the best way to understand it is to grab the clay and make a pot.
It's interesting how the artist is actually evoking a higher truth, but a lot of that comes through a realm of understanding that's just intuited. They don't necessarily even know. And then there's rare cases where guys like Josh have combined both art and science and then just stumbled or been connected with the right people. Not only has the art evolved as a result, but the person, Josh himself, and the understanding that he has. So to be able to express it can be difficult in terms of a common language, because I deal with that every day with the people I communicate with. Some of them have their idiosyncrasies as well, which I have to keep in mind. Sometimes I have to sort of change the way I approach a certain scientist or researcher, because they might be, you know, touchy about being contacted about their work. Josh was open right from the get-go, but he was also like, this is, you know, a really deep understanding. Where do we go? He was already on task, on track, and I saw a really great adventure there to be able to, for one, understand a little more about Coral Castle myself, magnetricity, but dually, that I have other people to connect with, and that builds this global understanding. I'm one that says by making a connection within yourself and between others, we actually make it available for others elsewhere that don't know us and are not connected to us. It just is all working that way.
We are definitely attracting like-minded people and people that we need to attract these days through, you know, synchronistic events.
I'm just humbled by the situations. You know, I hung out for a little bit with Randy Powell and Marko Rodin and, you know, the whole Rodin group. You know, those guys have some really amazing math, and it's simple. It's something that kids could learn great, and that's what Marko Rodin's going to do, is make a book for kids. That's the thing in math that always got me, was how do I apply this? Where is this tangible in nature? Like, give me that stuff. They just wanted you to know the equations, but I'm a very logical kind of mind where I want to apply it. It is just really an honor to be here talking with you all tonight, and it's my privilege to be in touch with the people that I have or to have learned from. I am no greater than anybody else. I am just standing in what my own truth is, trying to find out what's going on. This world is far stranger than we think it is. The term stranger than fiction, you know, they don't just say these things.
Why don't you talk about how a scenario that you told me the other day about the spider web, how the energy, you know, and how the vibration flows.
I think he was also talking about the stickiness, what makes a spider web sticky. And I believe there were people that were experimenting and saw some magnetism.
Yeah, there's some really amazing things. You know, nature is just a big metaphor. And, you know, spiders, they're in their web. And when something on the far side of their web hits, that the whole, it's like a kinetic lattice. The spider senses it and runs out to the butterfly. It's this lattice effect. It's like Newton's cradle. That's what everything is. Everything's these magnets, and either it's north or south, and it's these Newton's cradles, and they're attracting towards each other, and it's creating a geometry. Because if everything is the same substance, and like in the example I gave originally with the helium-2 superfluid, in that experiment also they can create an environment where it creates a perpetual fountain where it will flow up out of the glass underneath, and it creates this fountain effect. That's what geometry is. It's magnetism creating a flowing effect throughout all of nature. And that's why this geometry is so important with the Great Pyramid. Is it's given us the depth. It's given us the ratioed proportions to understand what is going on inside of magnets.
I like how you said that everyone should play with these angles and then shapes, and they can, too, see what you see.
Well, it's the only way, you know, Plato said it, yea, let no one ignorant of geometry enter. It was his school. You had to learn geometry. It's, you know, I took geometry and I got a D in geometry in high school. Now, the geometry was all about defining the circle, just alone, giving you all the equations of how the circle works, and then just the square, and then just the triangle. It didn't give you the spider web of how they interconnect. How they interconnect is via a hyperdimensional object, like a toroid, like the Great Pyramid.
That was my next question. How important do you think the torus is? Or is that a different shape than a toroid?
Well, it is the same. I guess it's all about how the energy is flowing. And a torus is a feedback loop of spirals where the energy flies out and comes back in. And that's what Searl's technology is talking about. That's what Ed talked about. He talked about radar signals and radio signals and how magnets go up and down in the earth. And he had crystal radios. Ed and Tesla and Searl and Stan Meyer, who was murdered, and John Hutchison. There's so many different connecting points. These people say the same terminology. They're learning their own way, but from an outside perspective, which is who I have been, looking at the internet, looking at these different books, seeing how it all coalesces into this mandala of self-expression. And that's what technology is. In French, technology means a technique. A technique can mean anything. It's like a tuning fork. You know, it just resonates, you know, dance. It resonates with your soul. You know, you've got posture. You've got different angles on your body movement. You know, it's just different expressions of how geometry is, the hieroglyphs.
There's a mechanics to language and a mechanics to thought and analysis. Some of it's philosophical, some of it's experimental or experiential. So there's lots of ways to communicate, but we lack in this, at least in the West, in our times, the other teachings. We get taught logic, grammar, and rhetoric, how to talk, how to write, how to think. But we don't get taught what they got taught in more ancient times as well, which is numbers, music, geometry, and astronomy. They called them originally the seven liberal arts. So that's what happened. When I detached from school and I went sort of seeking the truth, I ended up unexpectedly, I didn't look at liberal arts. I knew nothing about that. And I realized that it kept coming back to geometry. I went, again, the same subject is where I find a little more understanding and find new people to connect with. Well, yeah, that's truly where it's at. We don't have to learn it, but to become involved, it helps for the common language to exchange with others, to have a piece of that so you can communicate across, where Josh knows tons of stuff about electricity, which I do not, but we can still talk about it and share what levels we can communicate to. If he says a keyword that I know, and I know a researcher that specializes in that, boom, connection made. End of that conversation, and we just move forward from there. So these older arts have been lost, and you know, art is kind of the comprehensive grab bag of all those in one.
My hope is that this show ignites some fascination in other people who like this information, and they can then build on and communicate with you and build on the information that you have shared today. That's my hope, is that it's used as an educational tool, and maybe people can donate to the causes that you mentioned.
Well, we have to, because that we're at a turning point in our culture right now, not just as the American Empire, but as the world. Like, where do we want to go in the next 20 years? Do we want starvation and hunger and, I mean, you can go on with all that. Or do we want to create garden paradises where people work 20 hours a week and can have time to go to the Little League game with their son and to not have to slave drive and have divorces? I mean, our culture is falling apart. It's becoming decadent. Like, there's no time. People are poor. They're shooting drugs up. I mean, there's real problems going on. And I really feel in my heart that if people weren't enslaved to technology, because technology should have empowered humanity to set us free, but it's becoming bondage, where you have to pay the cell phone payment every month. You have to buy for your internet. You have to, because it's all this game of sucking energy out of us. Mm-hmm. And what we need to do is to find empowerment to live self-sustained, and to we need to look up. There's so many negative things to really focus on, and you know, to be aware of them is empowering too. We just have to get through this, and we have to make the right decisions, and to sit back and do nothing and to just say somebody else has to do it, it's being a coward.
Absolutely.
And our forefathers were dangerous men, according to King George. You know, he wanted to kill George Washington. He wanted to kill Ben Franklin, Thomas Jefferson. You know, these men weren't perfect. They were just men trying to survive in a tyrannical system. And we have a central banking system right now. We've got a military-industrial complex. We've got the media industrial complex. You know, it's the deck is stacked against us right now, but Nikola Tesla, Ed Leedskalnin, these people gave us this beacon of knowledge, these ideas of interconnectedness, and it was to uplift the idea of liberty, and it was to give us true freedom, not just freedom of speech. It's to give us our own self-empowerment.
Well said, Josh. There's a girlfriend of mine who's on the call. She'd like to add something or ask a question. Liza, would you like to ask Josh, Fred, or Zach a question?
Oh, yeah, I'd like to. You know, Josh, you just said everything is stacked against us. I'd like to put it in the past tense because this conversation with all these people is an example of how we're not unstacking because that's negative. I just want to say what I get from everything that you're saying, and my mind has gone all over the place. You've just covered so much. But everything we need to know is right there in nature. It's right there in front of our eyes. And you know what's really sad is that's the great mystery. That's the great beauty, you know, of it all. And I see education and science. Like science, yeah, everyone thinks science is true. But science and education, what it's done is to compartmentalize things to the point where even in the military, one person does not know what the next person's doing. We all have, you know, different, you know, backgrounds and information, and I really see a gelling and coming together. I just feel so inspired by listening to what you're talking about. And just this week, I saw the Tesla CD turbine pencil sharpener. A friend of mine sent that to me, and it blew my mind. And my nephew, like, last year is into quantum physics. He started explaining it. You know, we're beginning to realize something doesn't resonate. There's a big block here. So instead of, you know, focusing on where people disagree, I just want to thank you that I was able to even listen to this. And it's like waves, you know, it's going out. It's uninterrupted. When you said the dream catcher, you know, I've spent a lot of years living with Native people. And when you see the way what they believe in has been so cut off at the knees, it's just the very same thing that we're talking about in terms of we've been fractured, but I really see tremendous healing, and I'll be quiet, and I just thank you very much.
Well, thank
That's
you.
That's beautiful. Brian. Thank you, Liza. I mean, making this child, back to the original story I shared about the birth, to consciousness, we're connected on a higher level. Do we know that yet? Can we do something about it? Yeah. We can be inspired. We can connect. Infinitely beautiful family, we can do something about it. But those that want us to be involved, we are not responsible for any of those that chose to take this technology and use it unwisely and unfairly. But we see that, and we can take a step back, come together, get our minds straight, get our hearts straight, and then where we get excitement and the spark actually ignites inside of us, for me, that's bridging like-minded people together. It's very simple for me. I have these skills on the internet to do so, and I think I have the communication skills to connect all these disparate, seemingly disconnected subjects and people together. That's where I jumped into, and I feel the calling there. Josh is more of an experimenter. He has the hands-on know-how, and so we got to bring this stuff forward however we can do it.
I dare anyone else out there that wants to talk to me or talk to John Depew or people in this field, like, it is not getting the coverage that it needs. We need to find, we need to move, we need a million volt march. We need to all become empowered little capacitors and just start shocking people. We need to literally spread the information. Take the time to bring up Coral Castle to somebody. Take the time to just find what's in your own heart and do it. And this is what's in my heart, is that my generation should have had a different life, but because of corruption, greed, and fear, we are in the place we are. We feared to release technology because we didn't know what would happen. Well, it's too late. Like, we had the dustification of the biggest buildings on Earth. They turned to dust, and Dr. Judy Wood is...
In seconds, they turned to dust. It's like, and Shazam, poof, there's dust.
And just to buy the propaganda that was given to us by the government is, I mean, it's lazy. It is lazy. And the first thing we need to do is stop being embarrassed. We need to stop having that little block of, oh, I don't want people to think different of me. You know how many people that have just stopped talking to me in my life because I brought up things? People are afraid of things. And
they're afraid of what they do not understand, Josh.
Well,
and that comes from ego and fear.
It does come from ego and fear. And I'm not right. all the time. But, you know, I'm the first to know that I don't know anything. This stuff is so amazing and out there and ridiculous that it blows my mind that we can even be so arrogant to say. And, you know, we're always looking out in the world or out in the universe for alien signals or stuff like that. We've got alienated people in our society, John Searl, Tesla, with alien information that we don't even understand unless you talk to the person, but most of them are dead.
So true. Sad, but true.
I am the rattlesnake, and I'm ready to bite.
You go, Josh. You go.
I completely understand these feelings. I mean, we're at this time. I think part of it is it's important to remember how to approach people, because what you're feeling is, you know, a certain type of anger where you know, you wish more people would just take a look and, you know, start questioning a little bit more. And, you know, I found myself, you know, in the last couple of years, I would want to just yell at people, like we've talked about 9/11 a few times, in regards to just how certain things happen. And I would, like I said, I would want to yell at them, just wanted to say, like, are you just that stupid? What's the matter with you? But instead, I've realized that that approach is just, it's not right. You know, it's not the right approach. You have to bring them in. You have to, you know, just slightly pique their interest. Like, I had a coworker who I was talking to 9/11 with, and he just turned to another coworker and asked him, so what do you think about 9/11? And the guy was just like, yeah, I think Bin Laden did it. And then I mentioned, I was flabbergasted, but I kept cool, and I was like, really, do you think two planes can really take down three buildings?
Well, there were more than that. There's building four and three, and there was a whole complex there that went missing.
Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, I was essentially referring to building seven, and you just pique their interest with building seven and then see where they'll go. Like, you don't want to tell them, look, the entire complex was taken down with direct energy weapons. Then they'll just look at you and say, like, what the hell are you talking about? You're crazy. So,
and that's been our test, too, to get more flies with honey, if you will, and to keep our own egos in check while we are the ambassadors for this information.
Right. I've been through this phase myself where I was built up in my own mind about how, with 9/11 as an example, I was awake and aware that day, and I knew something was up. And I learned a lot. I have 4 YouTube channels that do not have my name attached to them anywhere. I uploaded 1,000 hours of stuff on HARP and chemtrails before I knew anything about scalar wave technology. I've already sort of got 25 different blogs about all these documentaries that have been done on these subjects, and many have researched it since then. It's been a long time ago now, but the same effect still resonates. When you approach people with the wrong attitude, it's your attitude that they pick up on, and then they close down instantly to the information, no matter how real it is, no matter how truthful it is, no matter if you know what you're talking about. So it's really good to, if it's an open forum, two-way discussion, and people are open-minded, you know that right off the get-go. But if they're not, don't start with a scary subject. Don't start with the things that agitate and aggravate people. You shake them up. But you do that later in the conversation. That's just from my experience, and that's why I think intelligence and knowing thyself is slightly on the back of not having an ego when you approach somebody.
Absolutely.
Well, yeah, well said.
Yeah, definitely. The best thing to do is to listen. I've listened to people talk, you know, patiently, and then I speak, and I don't get the same courtesy. And they always, instead of looking at links or, you know, being more curious and asking questions, there's something going on, and, you know, people just will walk away. They will not talk to me anymore or whatever, and experiments are the best way to do it, like you're saying, Zach, and just kind of reel them in with little bits of crumbs, like, and you know, at a certain point though, the reason I'm being so vocal in this interview is because this is the first time I've spoke publicly, and it's just upsetting that I have to do this. And you know, I could have kept playing baseball or gone and, you know, built a good relationship and not fixated on certain things, but you know, this is what's going on. It's in my heart. It's bothering me to know that should I have kids? You know, if they're just
good
be,
point.
I mean, what do I do? I am turning in, they're labeling me as a terrorist because of the things I look at, because I believe in liberty and I supported Ron Paul, or because I build pulsed energy magnet wheels.
How about the planes that fly over your house, Josh?
Well, I've had some weird things happen when I have my magnet wheels running, because I've built around 8 of these things, and it's these magnet wheels affect radio signals. They affect the TV signals. Like, I can shut off my TV in the other room that's just an antenna, you know, that picks up local stations. But this is a pulse signal. It's an electromagnetic pulse. And the government is going to start saying that this is, they're going to say it's terrorism. Well, it's because it affects technology that's outdated. The new technology is these pulsed, high conductive structures, these free energy or zero point, whatever you want to call it, whatever stigma word you want to attach to it to define it. What's going on is suppression of true development, and we need to become the butterfly and get out of the cocoon and fly. We are in a rut as society right now, and greed and lust and gluttony, those deadly sins, you know, the Catholics talk about. You know, you may not believe in the religion, but those things do destroy societies. It's mm-hmm. true. Every culture that turns decadent starts sacrificing kids and raping kids, and it's sad to say it. You know, Jimmy Savile in London just got, he's dead now, but he got, you know, up to 300 charges of child molestation now are coming out on him. And this guy hung out with the royal elite. You know, there's corruption going on, and do you want these kind of people having a Tesla death ray?
No.
And do you want to be naive to say that the Tesla death ray doesn't exist? Even worse, to say that, you know, it doesn't exist and that they have it? That's even worse, because then you believe their lies. Hitler said it. If you say a lie loud enough, simple enough, long enough, people will believe it.
Just look at the TV, for example.
yeah, I think everybody remembers about 10 years ago, weapons of mass destruction, weapons of mass destruction, weapons of mass destruction, right?
Yeah. Fred, is there anything you'd like to add in closing? Because we're running short on time here.
Well,
give me a chance to follow up.
Listen, I just want to, well, first of all, I want to thank you, Catherine, for letting me co-host tonight, and thank you, Tamara, as well, for letting me be with Josh and Zach, two guys that I have very, very high admiration for, and I'm really happy to have gotten to connect with both of these wonderful souls, because it's essentially, you know, it's people like them that have kept me on Facebook and getting to connect with different people. So just wanna thank all of you guys for all of this, for helping me awake. And parting words, I guess, for everybody would be just love. One love, one heart. Let's get together and feel all right.
I like it.
And, you know, that's about it. So thank you, Josh. Thank you, Zach. And
thank you.
Yeah, it was a great show. Thank you for letting me participate.
My pleasure, Fred. My pleasure completely. You're a good friend, and I've had many conversations with you, and I knew you'd be a perfect fit for this show. Zach, is there something you'd like to say in closing?
In closing, we all live our own internal process. We think we're talking to somebody outside of us. We think the stars are up there, and we look at them, and we're separate. And we think that science is all hard to understand, impossible. I'm not good at math. I'm not good at this. I'm not good at that. Our neighbor is us, nature is what we're made of. We are made of the same stuff as magnets. We're made of the same stuff as rocks. We're made of the same stuff. So if we find our vibe, if we find our flow, and we like it, stick with it. Break the strands to the old stuff you were doing and be inspired to dance, whatever that is. If it literally is dancing, then dance. If it's science, do that. It's not necessarily going to put you in a big house or a mansion. But that, when you leave this world, you'll be so much more invigorated to know you made a difference because you became what you are.
Was the world a better place because you were in it?
Yeah.
Excellent. How about you, Josh? We just have a minute or two.
I'm just really thankful to be able to have this, Kathy. I'm really thankful, humbled by it. There's so much to this. There's so many different experiments that we can elaborate on. There's different names I can bring out. There's a lot more to this. This is more of just bringing things together and trying to connect the dots that there is amazing technology out there, but we need to be spiritually sound and we need to become a mature race and really look at these things and not cower away from it.
Most definitely. Yeah. And I'd like to say Absolutely. To you, everyone who's here this evening, thank you for participating in the show. It's been my honor and pleasure as much as it has been yours. And we really appreciate you taking the time to hang out with us tonight and to share your knowledge with the audience. So thank you, guys. You're all great people.
Well, thank you again, Kathy. You're a phenomenal host, and it was a great show tonight.
Thank you. Okay, at this time, we just have a few minutes left. So on behalf of Tamara and myself, I would like to say thank you very much once again for being here, everyone. Our closing song is going to be called Elemental Damage, and it's by Moses Child. Take care, everyone. Peace.
Something happened.
Hi everyone, Tamara here. Just a reminder that you can connect with us through Facebook as well as subscribing to us on our YouTube channel. That's youtube.com/truthconnection. We'd love you to join us during live shows at blogtalkradio.com/truthconnections. And for information on upcoming shows, visit our website at truthconnections.wordpress.com. Thank you for your support, and never forget that the truth is reality, and the connection is you.
See the children on the trees, it's boulevard. They got no papas and a life that's blown apart. They never seen true love, they think that it's a dream, living without a plan. Look at everybody's children when you judge the world you live in, and hope more for tomorrow. Keep them free from worry, be there for their pain and the dark fears of tomorrow. Seen, but make him no demands.
Gotta look at your own children when you judge the life you're living. Work more for tomorrow. Keep them free from worry. Be there for their pain. And the dark fears of tomorrow. Gotta look at your own children when you judge the life you live in. And work more for tomorrow. Keep them free from worry. Be there for their pain. And the dark fears of tomorrow.